Welcome to another MedCram lecture. We're going to talk about nephrotic versus nephritic syndrome. Now, these are both syndrome types that occur in the kidney. And the question is, what's the difference between them and why do they happen in the first place? And to understand that, we really need to get into the pathophysiology of how these syndromes are different. So what we have here is a picture of a cross-section of the capillaries in a kidney. And what we have here is the endothelium. This is the endothelial cell, and it completely surrounds the lumen of the vasculature. And you notice that there's little slits here that allow things to get through, but not the red blood cells typically. Then this blue line represents the basement membrane, which is permeable to a number of things. And then finally on the outside is this epithelial cell. Now, the epithelial cell has little foot processes that you see here that look like little triangles around the edge. And basically, these form a very tight sieve, which allows only very small things to get through. Typically, not even proteins are allowed to get through here. Proteins are too large. And these, what we call podocytes, are helpful for that. So if you want to imagine that we've got fluid, okay, leaving, and when that fluid leaves the vasculature lumen and goes through the slits in the endothelium and the basement membrane and comes out even through the podocytes of the epithelial cells in the kidney, what we're left with here is basically Bowman's space. This is in Bowman's capsule, of course. And all of this fluid eventually, unless it gets reabsorbed, is going to go down into the toilet, okay? And it flushes down. So basically, anything that gets outside this area is going to eventually end up in the urine. I think that's a very important thing to remember. If you can remember the schematic of what a glomerulus looks like, you'll remember that you've got a vasculature that comes in and then leaves, and you've got a Bowman's capsule here that picks that up. That's what we're looking at here in this picture. And that gets picked up, goes into the proximal convoluted tubule, down the descending loop of Henle, up the ascending loop into the distal convoluted tubule, and then into the collecting ducts, and then out again to the toilet. So once again, this is a epithelial cell, and this is a endothelial cell. So what I'd like to do is I'd like to divide this picture, if you will, into two. And on this side, we're going to talk about nephrotic syndrome. And on this side, we'll talk about nephritic syndrome. So nephrotic syndrome is fairly straightforward. It's a process where, for some reason, these podocytes, which are all connected to the epithelial cell, aren't working, or they get lost, or they recede, or they involute. Something makes them disappear. And as a result of that, they're not able to keep the protein in. And so as a result of that, there is loss of protein. And it's quite substantial. In fact, on the order of 3.5 grams of protein per day can be lost. Now, this tremendous loss of protein has its consequences. One of the first symptoms that you'll see is that the urine is very frothy. Because frothy urine is caused by protein in the urine. Now, don't get alarmed if your urine is frothy, because there's a certain amount of protein that's in there naturally, I guess. There is some surfactant and other type of chemicals that'll make naturally your urine frothy. But if it's especially frothy, think about protein in the urine. Now, as a result of this, you're also losing protein. So if there's not enough protein in your intravascular space, you're not going to be able to keep that fluid in the intravascular space, and you're going to have more leakage of fluid. And so this is what we see in patients with loss of protein, is they become edematous, and they'll have edema just about all over their bodies, periorbitally, even in their legs, and sometimes even in their lungs. Probably the main loss of protein is albumin. Albumin is the major protein that keeps fluid in the blood vessels. Now, when albumin goes down because of its loss, the liver has to compensate. And when the liver compensates, we get increased lipids in the blood. This is another sign of nephrotic syndrome. There's also another protein that's lost called antithrombin 3. Now, antithrombin 3 is a very important anticoagulant. In fact, it's the same protein that heparin utilizes to exert its effect. So the point is that if antithrombin 3 is also going down in this situation, the patient is going to have a hypercoagulable state. And since this protein is lost here in nephrotic syndrome because these podocytes are not working very well, the renal vein, this is the blood going back after it's lost, is going to be especially poor in antithrombin 3. And that's where we tend to see thrombosis. And if there's a thrombosis in the renal vein, this could embolize and you could get blood clots to the lung. So you should think of DVTs and pulmonary embolisms, or PEs, in patients with nephrotic syndrome. So to review nephrotic syndrome, it's basically a problem with the podocytes, or even the basement membrane, anything that allows protein to sieve through here, causing frothy urine, decreased albumin, increased lipids both in the serum and also in the urine. Okay, you'll see antithrombin 3 being reduced, that leading to a hypercoagulable state. Typically, there's about 3.5 grams of protein lost per day. Now, there are diseases that are not of the kidney which can cause nephrotic syndrome. These are called secondary causes of nephrotic syndrome. And there are diseases which specifically affect the kidney which can cause nephrotic syndrome. These are called primary nephrotic diseases. We'll talk about those in another lecture. Now, on the nephritic side, completely different mechanism of action for causing nephritic syndrome. Whereas before there was a problem with the loss of podocytes, in nephritic syndrome, what we have is immune complexes. So an antibody meeting up with another antigen and complexing. This type of an immune complex will lodge itself in the capillary, as seen here, and it will elicit an immune response against these capillaries and against these antigens. Now, as a result of this, a number of white cells are recruited, as drawn here. There will be many more white cells. As a result of this inflammatory response to these immune cells, these areas will become inflamed, break down, and it will allow red blood cells to pour through these openings. Not only that, but also white blood cells to come through. And of course, since these openings are big enough for whole cells to get through, there's also very easily allowed for protein to come through as well. And so very often, even though the patient may have nephritic syndrome, they may also have what we call nephrotic range proteinuria. So the protein may also be high in nephritic syndrome and leading to all the things that we saw over here in nephrotic syndrome. But in addition to that, there's something that's very, very different. Remember, we said all of this stuff on the outside eventually goes into the urine. And so what do you think we would expect to see in the urine? In addition to protein, as just mentioned, we would also expect to see blood in the urine, sediment in the urine because of this breakdown products, and also what we call pyuria, or white cells in the urine as well. And so as a result of this, there are a few symptoms that we see in this nephritic syndrome. The first thing we see is hematuria. That's blood in the urine. The next thing that we'll see is oliguria, or low urine output. And that's because the glomerulus is being damaged, and so it can't filter as much because this immune deposition here is not going to allow the free filtration of filtrate. It's going to become inflamed, and the glomerulus is going to start to shut down. That causes a low GFR. The other thing that you'll see is high blood pressure because of that lack of filtration, so hypertension. The last thing you'll see is granular casts. So this is the main difference between nephritic and nephrotic. Usually there's more inflammation on the nephritic side. There's less on the nephrotic side. Typically, if you just see an increase in protein in the urine at very high levels, like 3.5 grams a day, and nothing else, there's no active sediment is what they would say, then think of nephrotic syndrome. If, on the other hand, you see a lot of cells, debris, sediment, and inflammatory cells, think of nephritic syndrome. Now, just in nephrotic syndrome, where there are primary and secondary diseases which can cause nephrotic syndrome, there are also primary and secondary diseases that can cause nephritic syndrome, and we'll discuss that in upcoming lectures.